was a wonderful sermon today.
Yeah, Pastor Jeff always gives a great message.
You know what else is great about La Casa? I hear adult ed classes are starting again.
Oh, there's Liz Lucas. Liz,
hi. It's good to see you all.
A little bit about adult ed, please.
Oh, I've got a new class that's starting that I think you would really love. It's based on the first two chapters of 1 Samuel, and it deals with his family and all the issues that they had to face, like anxiety, depression, eating disorders, bullying, jealousy, and it just goes on and on. But these are all problems that we face or our friends are facing now. And it shows us how God can come into our lives and give us the strength and power to overcome these issues. But you know, I'm not the only one that's going to be teaching the class. Pretty soon, Wayne's class is starting, and it sounds so great. Can you tell us a little about it, Wayne?
Yes, thanks for asking. The class is called My Neighbor's Faith. Now, we all have friends, neighbors, in-laws, people we work with who belong to different churches, Baptist, Methodist, Episcopal, and maybe we've often thought, well, I wonder how their church is different from our church. I wonder how what they believe is maybe the same as what we believe. Well, in this class, we're going to look at least eight different denominations across America. Each week, we'll look at a different group. We'll look at how they worship, what they believe, where they came from, how they might have a lot in common with or be very different with the kind of worship that we do. So I encourage you, if you've ever had questions, what do they believe? Who are they? Where do they come from? Come to the class, and we'll give you those answers, and you can move on from there.
I can't wait to sign up. Well, can I sign up online for your class?
You can sign up online right now. It's on, there's a link on the newsletter that comes out every week, and you can go right to the website and sign up there.
Great.
Wow. Oh, great. Let's do it.
Let's do it, yeah.
Thank you, Liz and Wayne, for telling us about your adult ed classes. We have many other classes coming up over the next several months in our adult education ministry, and we encourage you all to go to our website, lacostacristo.com/adult-education, to find out more, and if you're interested, please sign up. So thank you for joining us, thank you for staying connected, and now let's get ready to worship.
Good morning. Bill and I have a thing, in case you ever see us before worship and you see us grabbing our nose, that usually means that, I don't know if any of you do that, nose goes. That means the last person to grab their nose has to speak, and we forgot to do it this morning, and Bill's
Tag,
ignoring
I'm it.
Me.
Tag, he's it. We just didn't tell
Sam's
you.
Sam's it.
How you guys doing? Isn't it great to hear how life is ever changing? There's no constant except for change itself. Well, except God, right? I love hearing people's stories when they start talking about how God showed up, right? You ever hear that? And they're talking about how horrible things were and just nothing went right, and then God showed up. That's a great thing, right? What does that mean, though? God showed up. It happens in one of two ways, I think. It's when we align our heart and our spirit with God, and we feel His presence. We feel Him in our life. Or it's when God causes His spirit to mingle with ours. Whether you want to or not, you sense His presence. God shows up.
Invite you to stand to your feet as you're able. Let's just lift up the name of Jesus this morning together.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back. I know you are near. I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh, no, you never let go. Through the storm.
I can see a light.
I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. A glorious light beyond all compare. Troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know you're here on the earth. I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I?
Singing words of a song, we're singing about our holy, mighty Savior who loves us so much, who's always faithful, and he never lets us go. Amen.
The king of my heart be the never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down.
See,
you're never gonna let, you're never gonna let me down. You're never gonna let, never gonna let me down.
Let him rise up this morning.
Amidst the challenges and adversity that we may face, help us to remember that you are always with us. As we focus on that message today, that you are with us always, even when it appears you are quiet, even when it appears you are silent in our life, we know that you are the God who is active, the God of resurrection. Amen. I'll invite you to be seated, and we're going to have a special children's message this morning. We're going to invite the kids just to remain seated this morning. We have a very special sights and sounds of what was going on here this past week. For those of you who follow us on social media, Instagram, YouTube, or Facebook, you know what went on this past week. But for those of you that weren't here or weren't a part of it or just want to see some more about it, let's see the sights and sounds of VBX.
Hey, La Casa family, my name is Stacy Medina, and I am the VBX director as well as the children's ministry director here at La Casa de Cristo. We have had an amazing week with over 150 volunteers and 450 students on our campus. Our week has started out each day with an amazing opening where we get to see our ringmaster and introduce our Bible story that we learn for the day. It's been so much fun with singing and dancing and learning all about God. As the kids separate into their new groups, they get to do amazing crafts, a frame, a cross, and all the different creative things that makes a great day. They've also gotten to go outside and inside for our recreation where they play games together, laugh together, run together, and have a great time experiencing fun as our La Casa family. The other thing that they do during the day is they go to our story time. It's story time where our amazing volunteers teach our Bible lesson for the day. We've learned a bunch of different themes like God is faithful and God is listening and all the important things that we want our kids to leave our campus knowing who God is and how amazing His love is for us. We have had such a great week with so much fun and laughter, and it's been great seeing our campus so incredibly full. Our hearts are full as staff and as volunteers, and we are just so grateful that you and your children have become part of our La Casa family. We have so many great things here at La Casa, and we can't wait to have you join us throughout the year for more fun. A huge thank you to all of our volunteers that have helped us to make VBX possible. From preparation to our volunteers all over our campus all week, there's no way that we could do VBX without you. We are so thankful for your time, your prayers, and for all that you do for us.
What do you like?
I like learning about God.
Indeed, all glory be to Jesus Christ, and we're so grateful for this past week. You know, our mission statement here at La Casa de Cristo is to love those who don't know Jesus and grow those who do. To love those who don't know Jesus and grow those who do. And many of the children that were here this past week may have never stepped foot on our campus before. Many of them may not have known about Jesus Christ, but thanks to our volunteers and our staff and all who contributed to this team effort this past week, the light of Jesus shone brightly here on our campus. Can we recognize our volunteers and staff for all they did this past week? And what we're going to do now is we're going to take a minute to share God's peace by moving out of our seats as we're still able and sharing that peace. And following the sharing the peace, we'll invite you to remain seated for our morning offering. Let's share the peace of God in Jesus Christ with each other.
Count on one thing, saying God never fails, will not fail me now, you won't fail me now, and in the waiting, the same God who's never late, is working all things out, you're working all things out, yes I will lift you up. In the lowest valley, yes, I will bless your name. Yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy. All my name, oh, yes, I will. I count on one thing, saying God never fails, he'll not fail me now, you won't fail me now, in the waiting, the same God who's ever made, is working all things out, working all things out, yes I will lift you up.
This is a reading from page 403 in your pew Bibles, Psalms 46. God is our refuge and strength and ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth gave away and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam of the mountains quake with the surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her, she will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar, kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice, the earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see the works of the Lord, the dissolutions he has brought on the earth. He makes war cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks a bow and shatters a spear. He burns his shields with fire. Be still, and I know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. The word of the Lord.
Please pray with me. Almighty God, may the words in my mouth and the meditations and prayers in each of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, for you are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Awkward, wasn't it? Silence. You expect after the pastor prays a prayer that he or she will begin to speak and begin to use words. And you know, we often don't know what to do with silence in our life. We don't know what to do with silence, and it is a time of awkwardness, and particularly in our spiritual life. We don't know what to do in our lives when it comes to silence from God. Over the past 8 weeks, we've shared together in a journey as we focused on prayer as a congregation and as a community of faith. And we've explored all sorts of different aspects of prayer. And today, I'd like to focus on what do we do when it appears God is silent in our life? What do we do when it appears that after many days or many weeks or many months of prayer, God is silent? You see, we make many assumptions about God in our life. We make many assumptions about God acting in our life, and we believe if we don't hear from God directly or if we don't see God, that somehow God is not active in our life. It's kind of like the assumptions one pastor in a small congregation in a small town made. The congregation was struggling financially, and he was looking for ways to save money. And so he decided that they would save money by eliminating all the paper towels that were used in the men's and women's restroom. And instead of using paper towels, that they would install the hot air hand dryers, that this would save them from the expense of using all of the paper towels. So he got approval from the board to go ahead and do this, and they installed the hot air hand dryers. But after only one Sunday of the hot air hand dryers being installed in the men's and women's restroom, he came back to the board and said, since these were still under warranty, that he wanted to return them. And they said, well, why, Pastor? You asked to do this to save money. Why are you returning them? Because someone from the congregation had put a sign up after the Sunday morning service, for a further sample of this morning's sermon, please push the button for more hot air below. The reality is, in your life and mine, we make assumptions about things, and they don't always pan out. So what is it about the silence of God in our life? How do we deal with the fact that when we pray, sometimes God appears silent? A couple years ago, there was a woman named Bertha Adams in Palm Beach County, Florida, and she died at the relatively young age of 73. And when she died, she weighed 65 pounds. She was emaciated. And she had traveled around the dumpsters in Palm Beach trying to scavenge for food, and also that was where she got her clothing from. And so upon her death, when they settled her estate, they discovered that Bertha was worth $2.5 million. Bertha was worth $2.5 million. And everyone said how foolish she was, how foolish that this woman who had all these resources spent her time traveling the dumpsters of Palm Beach, Florida for food and for her clothing.
And yet we who would criticize her for something like that far too often don't take advantage of the spiritual poverty in our own life and recognize that for what it is, because we have these great gifts from God. We have the gift of the Holy Spirit. We have the gift of His presence in our everyday life, but we don't take advantage of it, and we believe God is silent when we pray to Him. The first point that I'd like to share this morning is that we often believe God is silent in a time of crisis or adversity or challenge in our life, when we're going through hard times. We believe God isn't speaking to us. And maybe part of that is we believe that somehow we just deserve good things. I mean, after all, we're faithful people, we're good people, so after all, shouldn't we just deserve good things happening to us or for us in life? And so in the midst of all of that, what we can know and understand is it's in the very midst of crisis and adversity and challenge in life that we come to God, and in His apparent silence, we need to understand that God is still active. Our church has in its name the name Lutheran. And that is for a man named Martin Luther. You may or may not know this, but Martin Luther struggled with many things in his life, amongst them physical ailments, and he also suffered from what modern commentators believe was clinical depression. And one time in the midst of a terrible situation in his life, when things were very dark and when he was very depressed, he went into his study where he did much of his writing. And he went into his study and he saw on his desk there that there was dust all over his desk. And he went into his study and he was confused and he was frightened and he didn't know what the next step was. But in the dust on his desk, he wrote in Latin, "Vivet, vivet, he lives, he lives." In other words, in the midst of the depth of his problems, Luther claimed the promise of resurrection. And that's what you and I need to claim as well. When things aren't going the way we anticipate in life, when life isn't turning out the way we expect, understand He lives. A number of years ago, a woman in the parish I was serving at the time came up to me and said, "Pastor, you know, I've gone to church every day for the past 40 years of my life, but I've never felt closer to Jesus Christ than I felt in the past couple weeks. Do you find that odd? Do you find that strange?" And I said, "Not at all. That's a sign of resurrection. Jesus is active in your life. If God isn't answering your prayers in the way you expect, if you believe God is silent, understand that the God of resurrection is always with you. And He's getting ready to prepare you for that next chapter in your life." That's first, and this is second. We always find out. We always find out that when we reach the end of our human limitations, when we reach the end of our human limitations, and we turn to God, that's where we can see God most visibly in our life. And even if it sounds like He is silent, when we turn our life over to Him, we understand. You know, this spring, this summer, we looked at everything that was going to go on at La Casa this summer. Confirmation camp, our senior high summer trip, our VBX, all of our ministries, worship, all of our music, everything that we were looking at in our life together. And we wondered, how would God provide for us this summer? Would He bring forth the volunteers that we've needed in light of the past couple years? Would God provide? And we turned these things over to Him in prayer, and we turned them over to God. You see, when we reach the end of our ropes in life, when we reach the end of our human limitations, then we need to know and understand that God is present with us. In this famous psalm that Brenda read for us today, Psalm 46, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble." There's a very interesting background to this psalm that most people aren't aware of. You know, if you open your Bibles or your Bible app and you're doing your devotions at home or you're in a Bible study, you'll see as you look through the psalms that before each of the psalms, there's a dedication to the psalm itself. Some of the psalms were dedicated to David. Some of them were dedicated to anonymous people that we really don't know about, but Psalm 46 has a very interesting dedication, and you'll see it in your Bibles or your Bible app right before you read it. It says it's dedicated to the choir master and to the sons of Korah. The sons of Korah. Who was Korah? If you go back to the book of Numbers, you'll find Korah was not a very popular man. Korah, K-O-R-A-H, opposed Moses. Korah opposed God. And as punishment, the earth swallowed up Korah. He disappeared. And it's very interesting when you read Psalm 46, because maybe, just maybe, the psalmist was referencing his ignoble end and the way his life ended when he said, though the earth melt away and though the earth shake, God is still our refuge and strength. But God, being God, still provided. And the sons of Korah became instrumental in the life of Israel. The sons of Korah became the keepers of the music and the instrument in the tabernacle. They became the keepers of the musical instruments in the tabernacle. They became the musicians in the tabernacle and in the temple of the Lord. They were the ancient equivalent of our music ministry, our bands, our choirs here at La Casa de Cristo. The sons of Korah played an important part in the life of Israel. And so this psalm, God is our refuge and strength, is dedicated to them. So you see, despite adversity, despite challenge, despite the way Korah's life ended up, his sons had a new promise. They had a new gift. And when we come to the end of our independence, recognizing we can't do things on our own and turn it over to God in prayer, then we know that God is not silent in our life. And there is one more thing. There is one more thing. We need to understand that God's always going to show up in unexpected places and unexpected ways in your life and mine. He's not just going to show up here in the gathering place or in the sanctuary on a Sunday morning. He's not just going to show up on our campus, in our ministries here. That's where we expect him to show up, and he's certainly here. But he also will show up in our homes. He will also show up in our neighborhoods. He'll also show up in our workplace. He'll show up in a variety of ways and a variety of unexpected situations. Many years ago, I knew two men named Ralph and John. And in the church I was serving at that time, they were very active in the church. They were present every Sunday for worship, involved in the men's ministry. They sang in the choir. But over a period of a couple weeks, John noticed that Ralph wasn't himself. He noticed he just seemed down. Didn't seem himself. And so John kind of played on a hunch, and even though John was struggling in his own life spiritually, he decided to reach out to Ralph and invite him to a cup of coffee. And that morning, Ralph poured out his whole life to John. Problems in his marriage, problems with his children, problems in the workplace, unhappy in his job. So many things were going on, and in addition to that, he was struggling mentally. And after conversation and after prayer, Ralph thanked John and he said, "You know, John, thank you for inviting me to coffee today. Tomorrow would have been too late. I have a bottle of pills at home, and I was going to take them all tonight." We never know how God may use us in our lives. And you may recall last week we talked about that God gives us two hands, one for receiving and one for giving. Well, even when we are struggling in our life spiritually, even when we feel God is silent, God still calls us to reach out to others. That's a signpost of the Holy Spirit in our life, when we can be listening to others and understanding that they may be struggling. Maybe there's someone you haven't texted in a while, you haven't called, you haven't talked to. Maybe there's someone in your own family you need to reach out to and have an honest or tough conversation with. And in the midst of that, understand these are the moments when God is active in our life. You see, God is never silent. We just always don't look for Him in the right places. I recently taught a Bible study here at La Casa de Cristo in the spring, and I ended that study by talking about the intertestamental period of our faith. And the intertestamental period was a period of time from the end of the prophets, the end of the prophecies of Malachi, until Jesus was born. It was a period of 400 years, not 4 years, not 40 years, 400 years. 400 years that people did not believe that God was speaking to them, because they believed that God only spoke through the prophets. They believed that's the only way God could speak to them. They believed God was silent. But during that whole 400-year period, a whole series of things was taking place. There was a clash between the Greek culture and the Roman culture and the Jewish culture. Leaders rose and fell. And most important of all, the Hebrew scriptures were translated into the Greek. And because those were translated in that time into the Greek, then the New Testament came in the Greek. And then that was translated into Latin, and then that was translated into German, and then that was translated into English, so you and I could read the word, and all that took place during that time. And as Rome ascended, Rome did many terrible and evil things, but they also built highways and byways, so later the Apostle Paul could travel throughout the word, spreading the good news of Jesus Christ. God was not silent then. And He's not silent now. And if you think He is, then in the words of the famous book, your God is too small. The next time in your life that you're praying and you believe that God is not answering your prayers, look for Him in a time of adversity and crisis. Look for Him turning dead ends into new beginnings. Look for Him preparing you for the next chapter in your life. Come to the end of your own independence, thinking you can do it all and control it all, and turn it over to Him for guidance. And understand that then He will show up in unexpected places. You know, it was fascinating to me. We never plan these things, but when Sam spoke at the beginning of the service, we hadn't talked about this. We hadn't talked about my message. We hadn't talked about this service at all. But when he talked about God showing up, that was another marker of the Holy Spirit. God always shows up in your life and mine. He just may not show up in the ways and places we expected. God is our refuge. God is our strength, a very present help in a time of trouble. And God always shows up in your life and in my life. We are going to, at this time, share in the Lord's Supper. And this is another way that God shows up in your life and in mine. And maybe the past few times you've communed here at La Casa, you've gone through the motions. Maybe you've just come up to receive the bread and the wine and you really haven't thought about it much. But in this gift, this is the gift of Christ's body. This is the gift of His blood. This is our spiritual nourishment. And just like you and I need food physically to survive, we need this nourishment. We need His body, His blood in our life. God always shows up. In the night in which He was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks, and He broke the bread, and He gave it to them, and He said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this to remember me." And then again, after supper, He took the cup. He gave thanks, and He gave it to them. And He said, "Drink this cup, because now this is the new covenant. It's shed in my blood, given for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. As often as we eat this bread and we drink this cup, we proclaim Jesus' death until he comes again. Let's pray together our family prayer, the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. We'll invite the communion assistants to come up to the side of the altar here, and as they come forward, we'll also mention to you, if you're visiting with us for the first time today, and I know we have visitors with us today, you are welcome to the Lord's table. That's a free gift of God that he gives to all of his sons and daughters in Jesus Christ. We commune here by intinction, so we invite you to receive the wafer of bread and then dip it into the chalice of wine or hold it over the chalice of wine as you desire. God's gifts are ready for his people.
I love you, Lord, for your mercy never failed me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
As a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so
sing that verse again. I love your voice.
I love your voice. You have led me through the fire, the darkest night. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so good. With every breath that I inhale, I will see
good.
Your goodness is running out. It's running out.
take a few moments of silence. See how God is speaking to you in your life, because even though we may practice the gift of silence in our life, God is never silent to us. So let's take a moment and share in that time of quiet and silence before we pray together. God, we know that you are the God of resurrection. Wherever in life we seem to be at an impasse or a dead end, you always provide a way for us through the wilderness. As we look back at the history of your people, we see so many times and so many places where they thought you were silent, but all you were doing was working behind the scenes, getting ready for the next chapter, getting ready for the prophets, getting ready for the birth of Jesus, getting ready for his death on a cross, getting ready for his resurrection, and ultimately the spread of the good news around the world because of the gift of people reading and talking about an active God. Lord, as we come to you this Sunday, each and every one of us has different things happening in life. Each and every one of us has joys, and each and every one of us has concerns and worries. In the midst of all of that, help us to turn that over to you. And then, despite whatever those challenges may be, help us to remember that we are still called to serve you, to still reach out through the signposts of the Holy Spirit into the lives of others. Not just receiving, but giving of ourselves and giving of your love. And so as we come to this time and place, help us to remember that as this worship service ends, our service is just beginning. Amen. The Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord make his face to shine upon us and be gracious to us. The Lord look upon us with his favor and give us his peace. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen. We'll invite you to stand as we sing our closing song and blessing together. Let us shout with joy for the Lord.
Come, let us bow at his feet, for he has done great things.
See what the Savior has done.
He has done great things. He has done great things.
Faithful.
Yeah.